Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It gives us great pleasure to welcome the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Mr. Devendra Fadnavis here. Since today is a busy day, he has just flown in from Sholapur and he has a couple of programs to attend later. We were given the instructions that we had to curtail on our speeches and certain formalities. So we have curtailed all the speeches to the maximum. Yeah, I will at a later stage. He says that he is willing to give us a bit of time. So without going into the detailed formalities, may I now request the President of the Maharashtra Economic Development Council, Commander Deepak Naik, to welcome the Chief Minister and all of you. Commander Naik is also felicitating Shri Adi Godrej, who has been a past president of the MEDC. And with this, may I request the president of the MEDC to make his welcome address.
Honorable Chief Minister, Mr. Devendra Fadnavis. In this forum hereafter, I don't think I should address him as the Chief Minister because we've not invited him here in his capacity as the Chief Minister of the state. We've actually invited him in his capacity as the intellectual visionary for the state of Maharashtra that he's been all his life. This young-faced worker, shall we say, has worked for this state and the people of this state forever so far. And it's the first ever time that we are calling a non-academician to address the D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture. In fact, before I continue with welcoming the rest, I must mention some truth, and that is, there were some eyebrows raised at, say, me and my governing council that why are you departing from calling academicians and so on. The only way I could answer that, really speaking, is by a Sanskrit Subhashit, which says, na abhisheko na samskara sinhasya kriyate vane Vikramarjita Satvasya Swamaya Murgayandita, which means that to qualify to be the king of the forest, there is no coronation required for a lion. By his very birth, by his capabilities, by his being, by his deeds, he is adequate to be the king of the subject of called jungle. In much the same manner, young Devendra Fadnavis is actually fit enough and more than qualified to talk about Maharashtra's future, Maharashtra's economy, and which way this state should go ahead. With these words, let me extend a very warm welcome to you, sir, in this forum. Immediately following, of course, the VIP of the day, I must welcome the core of the diplomatic corps. We got some Consul Generals and members of Diplomatic Corps, thank you very much for coming over. Our past presidents are here, and that gives us a great pride. This year onwards, at this memorial lecture, which is once in a year, we've decided to honor one past president each. I must have done it in selfish interest without knowing so, because someday I too will be a past president maybe. And so we welcome Mr. Adi Godrej, who's been our past president in 93-94. There are four other past presidents sitting here. And it is these people, starting with Dr. Dhananjay Rao Gadgil, who have led the destiny of an institution called MEDC. A word about it a little later. There are some secretaries to the government of Maharashtra present here, past and present. Welcome you, sirs. Other government officials, presidents of chambers of commerce, association of industries. I'm glad to say the FAM is in very large numbers, I can see, and so is AHAR. Now, both of them are part of our constituent members, and it's really nice to see this interaction between FAM, AHAR with MEDC. Welcome to all of you. Quite a few of our, in fact, virtually every one of our patron members is seen here in this audience. It is these people, philanthropists such as them, which make organizations such as us efficient and make it working. Thank you, sirs. Last and not the least are the members of the media and the sponsors who make events possible. My special thanks to the LIC, NABARD, and EXIM, and the media who are present here in large numbers. Part of my job is to introduce the speaker, which I half did earlier, and let me complete the rest. Once again, I shall rely heavily on the scriptures in Sanskrit, where that's much like Urdu Shairi, very often expresses much too much in very few a word. Pibandi nasya swayameva, nabhya swayam na khadanti, phalani rukshaha, nadanti sasyam khalam varivaha, paropakaraya satavikuta. Rivers don't drink the water they make or carry. Trees don't eat the fruits they bear. Clouds don't eat the crops they nurture. There are a few human beings who work for others and not for themselves. That's our chief guest today and the speaker of the day, Devendra Fadnavis. What I'm going to talk hereafter, sir, basically to brief you, and to those of you who are new to MEDC as an institution, is a few minutes of the past, a few minutes of the present, and the few minutes of future of MEDC. The Chambers of Commerce in 1957 got together, and there were people like Mr. Malerkar, Garwari, and K.H. Dhamderi, who got together and they said that we must have an apex body which will be a council of the Chambers of Commerce. It will be an axis between the government of the time and the industry of the time or the commerce of the time to be an axis between them for growth of economics, or economical advancement of our state, every part of our state. Ever since then, and the first president chosen by them together was Professor Dr. Dhananjay Rao Gadgil, a visionary indeed. What did he do, and what did we do in the past, in other words, through the hands of the past presidents who are present here? MEDC became, through Dr. Gadgil, the originator of the cooperative movement in Maharashtra. Whether it was cotton textile cooperative mills, sugar cooperatives, and so on. The very idea of employment guarantee scheme germinated in MEDC. Very few people know about it. The Gadgil formula of allocation of taxes or share of taxes between the state and the center is pretty well known and is followed by the Finance Commission even today. In more recent times, we've been conducting events and a continued series of things called Golden Maharashtra. We promote our state in a manner that whether it is foreign direct investment, whether it is new industries, but they all come here. We kind of market our state for and our industry, small scale industry in particular, to ensure that balanced growth happens in all regions of Maharashtra. Occasionally, some time ago, some three, four governments ago, we've also done the task of writing the report card on the government of the time, of measuring, sir, the promise versus performance of the governments that has been. We created a vision document for Maharashtra in 2005. And that was, I must say this, when I say MEDC, it also means a whole lot of co-opted experts which come on our panels and who are expert economists, expert scientists, expert agriculturists, expert industrialists, and so on. In fact, the vision document has been created time and again. We would be only too glad to continue to do so, because now the vision, I think, is something which is cyclic in order. We've got to do it again. The regional township policy, another very valuable input that MEDC did right around the entire state. Some of you must know that when it came to CIDCO, and we continue to work for CIDCO even today as consultants, there are 20 years vision documents was made by this organization. One of those days, in very recent times, 2 years ago, we put leading economists such as Dr. Kelkar and others in a closeted session for a few days, and we said we will record what you speak, but what you're going to make out is what should be India's next big reforms. We've been through a reform cycle good 91 onwards, but then what should be the next big reforms? And we produced a document called The Next Big Reforms. I'll be only too glad to present a copy to you, sir. Well, that's about past and what is the present. I've encapsulated the past rather tight. I shall encapsulate the present even tighter. We have many, many thrust lines, but let me concentrate on three, wherein we in MEDC, much like our past, shall work very closely together with you, sir, and your government. We intend putting Mumbai on the air show map of the world. There are air shows which have very specific purpose. There are defense air shows like the one which happens in Bangalore, the second biggest in the world. There is Farnborough, which is much like that. There are static air shows for commercial aircraft. There are air tattoos, which are showing air displays and formats of different kinds of flying. We intend making a difference. We intend making a Mumbai International Business Aircraft Air Show, which will also bring in MROs and maintenance facility in Maharashtra, sir, together with a component of defense which will come with it automatically, wherein the aircraft components and the consumables, be it for the war aircraft or Air Force aircraft or fighters, be it for the commercial airliners, but we should take it in furtherance of making Maharashtra policy. That, in a nutshell, will be the Mumbai Air Show, and we promise you that we shall organize together with the government of Maharashtra and the MEDC an air show which will be one of its kind, where the world would look forward to coming every alternate year. So that's one of our present large objectives. The second one, and we've already embarked upon it, it'll come up to you in due course of time through your departments, but we've had series of parlays with the MTDC and together with the Tourism Development Corporation. We have launched on developing our pilgrimage centers as tourist destination of world-class facilities. And what's better than starting with Ashtavinayakas, as we always start everything good with invoking Ganesha. So we put up a proposal, which has been accepted by the MTDC, that we'll create a master plan for the development of the Ashtavinayakas in a manner that is befitting a tourist of every class, whether he comes in a red ST bus or whether he flies down in a helicopter. The facility should be available. Clean drinking water should be available. The prasad that we eat should not end up becoming a stomach problem tomorrow. And right from the street furniture to branding the Ashtavinayakas, it will become a world-class tourist center. That is what we put up to MEDC, and it will come up to you, sir, in due course of time. And the third thing, not so well baked as yet, and still en route, is we wish to join together with you, sir, in making a Kokand Vikas Arakhada. We know it's hotspot. We know it's ecological problematic area, but it doesn't mean that it becomes a complete no development zone. We need to create a plan of what can be done where, in which specific location. And that is where we have the competence, we have the manpower, we have the ability, and we have the rapport of working with the government. Having said that, sir, of the present, let me say a little even lesser about the future, because that largely depends on how we take up these three tasks now and how we progress further. But all I wish to say is that, and assure you, sir, is the economy of the state in the past 6 years has grown by leaps and bounds. We've been leaders in this country as far as the economic growth is concerned. But then again, if we take away, let's say, the three refineries here, and if we take away, let's say, the headquartered offices in Mumbai, and if we measure human development index of our different districts, are we there? Are we ahead of everybody else? So we need to recast, shall we say, with expert opinions, our path to progress for Maharashtra's economic advancements. And this, in future, we wish to do together with you, sir. Having said that, I will conclude again with a couplet, this time differently, wherein I shall not only talk of you, but also talk of us, and say, kitno ki takdeer badalni hai tumne, kitno ko raaste pe lana hai tumne, apne haath ki lakeeron ko mat dekho, in lakeeron se aage jana hai humne. Thank you.
Thank you, Commander Naik. With that, we come to the time when we need to set the tone for the D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture. Like all the D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture, there is a very short time wherein we set the tone. When we saw the CM's busy schedule, we decided that we drop the set the tone. I sent him an SMS that we have dropped the setting of the tone. He said, no. I'm hard pressed for time, but no, you shall not drop setting the tone. For 11 D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lectures, you have had the setting of the tone. You will continue, but do it briefly. So I'm not going to make a speech on setting the tone. I shall only flag issues. And the issues are good enough for a chief minister like Mr. Devendra Fadnavis to understand what it is and what is meant by setting the tone. The share of agriculture in the state GDP is 12%. The number of people dependent on this GDP of 12% is 50%. On one hand, when you have almost 50% of the state's population living in urban areas, 12% GDP caters to 50%. We need to do something about it. The productivity gap needs to be addressed. And how do we do this? Irrigated land has not increased by more than 1% in the past 20-25 years. In a state like Maharashtra, where it was expected that at least 20-25% of the land would be irrigated, and we increase our irrigated land at the rate of at least 2% per annum, we have brought ourselves to a situation where we really wonder what we are doing to irrigate our land. Some new thoughts were given at the level of MEDC. And one of the projects that was taken up for study by the MEDC was the Neera Deugar project. And in that, we gave recommendations to the state and to the Water Resources Board, the chairman of which Mr. Buddhi Raja is present here today, as to how without depending on government funds, the canals that presently are not built, and the dams have been built, but the water doesn't reach those lands which need to be irrigated, can be done without the state having to spend a single penny. Partial urbanization will increase time to time, and unless the lands get irrigated without the government doesn't really have the wherewithal and the money. So we have to find new ways by which, without the government spending that money, we can really irrigate more and more land and take it to the 20% mark at least in the next 5 years. Some out-of-the-box thinking. We had a group of geologists from different parts of the world who mapped through satellite the deep water aquifers. I'm not talking of the underground water table. I'm talking of the aquifers which are 1 kilometer to 2 kilometers under the ground, which never get touched, which haven't been touched for 1,000 years. The Massachusetts Institute of Technology in Boston had a team which came to Maharashtra and did a study where we found that huge amount of aquifers still have capacity to store enough water which will last us for 10 years. The water from Konkan which flows into the sea, if that water through bores can be taken to these underground aquifers and they be charged, then from the other side of Konkan, that is other side of the Western Ghats, in the rain shadow region, there could be bores built straight to those aquifers, and Konkan water feeds the aquifers, and those areas which presently do not have rain can then be irrigated out of these aquifers. This is out of the box thinking, and if the state wants to come forward, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology is willing to send their team at their expense and cost to do a detailed study and present it to the government of Maharashtra, and MEDC shall be happy to do that. Making business in this city easy, making business in this state easy is one of the targets that the Chief Minister and the government has set to itself. Mere approval process and expediting the approvals is not enough. Unnecessary license and permits, which are not required, which were meant for the British rule, we are an independent country, should be eliminated. Our members of the Hotel and Restaurant Association, AHAR, are here. They tell me that as many as 32 licenses and permits need to be taken to start a 500 square feet restaurant to sell simple things. And if any one of those licenses and permits expire, what they have to do cannot be told on public platform. Every day is a challenge, and every day new people come in, and every day rent seeking happens, and people have to bear it, and doesn't make business easy. They have to close down their business. To add this comes the new housing policy. It is indeed laudable, Mr. Chief Minister, that you believe that every single citizen in this city can get housing as per his capacity and affordability. We agree with you completely. That is possible. There are people who are doomsday predictors who say that can never be done, because presently we build only 20 to 25,000 houses every year, and what we require is 2.5 million houses, 25 lakh houses. A lot of people say that that is not possible. We feel that is possible, but that requires a vision, that requires a break from the past, and that requires some innovative thinking. We are willing to do that thinking for you, and that is something which I leave to you. While on the housing policy, I must flag this issue that the Rent Act has been challenged and the matter is before the Supreme Court. While the matter is before the Supreme Court and the landlords want 25 lakh people in Mumbai alone and more than 75 lakh people in the different parts of the state to be evicted by increasing their rent to the market rent, which will cause undue hardships. some recommendations in the housing policy, sir, need to be revisited, wherein 50% of South Mumbai's restaurants will close down and 5 lakh people in the city of Mumbai will be rendered homeless if such amendments are enacted. We want to meet you to meet the people affected. We want you to understand the issue and we want you to take a positive step in that. And I'm sure with your kind of understanding of the problem, we can never go wrong. When the development plan issue was brought to your notice, you were the first person, unlike other chief ministers, to go ahead and say, if wrongs have been done, I shall rectify them. If they are wrong enough and they have to be changed, I shall change them. If they are wrong and it needs to be scrapped, I shall scrap it. That is the capacity that you have and you have shown in the past. The same capacity is expected out of you, and people then feel that here is a chief minister who thinks for us. Similarly, the Rent Act needs to be understood. Suggestions for affordable housing are there in the policy, but these suggestions are in MMR region. Those suggestions are not really applicable in the city of Mumbai, Thane, and so on. The policy says that 5 years annual income should be enough for a person to buy a house. The highest paid civil servant, whether he be the rank of chief secretary or anybody in the state of Maharashtra, earns about 1 lakh rupees a month, which means 12 lakh of rupees a year, which means 60 lakhs of rupees in 5 years. In 60 lakhs rupees, sir, in Mumbai, the person of the rank of a chief secretary cannot even buy a garage in a place where he stays today. The rates of the flats have gone up to 1 lakh rupees, 1 lakh 20,000 and so on. And something needs to be done about it. The housing policy and urbanization policy needs to be revisited. The state is the fastest growing urbanized state in the country. We have about 50% of our population living in urban areas, and more are joining in a big way. The state requires out of the box thinking for a new urbanization policy, not just a housing policy, a policy for urbanization which studies the processes of urbanization, studies the infrastructure, studies the carrying capacity, and creates a capacity for the state so that every individual has pleasure in living the way wherever he wants to live. Production of electricity, you know, some out of the box thinking. There is a huge amount of produce from the electricity that you can do from the waves. Just in the Thana Creek, there was a study undertaken very recently by a German group and an American group, and they have come to a conclusion that just out of tidal energy in Thana Creek alone, we can create enough electricity not just to power the JNPT, but also to power the adjoining places in Navi Mumbai, Thane, and Mumbai as well. They are even willing to set up a pilot project at their expense to prove to us that this kind of a tidal electricity can be generated. We need the thinking. Tourism policy not restricted to Ashtavinayak alone. Tourism policy with 700 kilometers of coastal way, Bombay to Goa, every single spot can compete with any part of Goa today. We really need to have a proper policy. The beautiful forests in the areas where you come from, whether it is Tadoba or the other places in Vidarbha, need to come on the international tourism map. When we talk about the tiger, we talk about North India, we talk about Bandhavgarh. Now, of course, people are started talking about Maharashtra, but we need to take that at an international level. Human development index is something which we need to understand. If you remove Mumbai, Pune, and Nasik from GDP, from the state's GDP, the rest of the state's GDP, district-wise, if you check the human development index, we will not be very amused. It would not be something which we would be proud about. So we need to do so many things. We have achieved a lot. You in your 6 months have shown that you have the gumption and the courage to admit faults of the government, if there are faults, to admit that something needs to be done out of the box, to go out of the way and do things which are good. In your stewardship, these are the issues which I have flagged. For paucity of time, I curtail myself not to flag more issues for you, but I promise you that if we coordinate and interact, this magical figure of 3 lakh 20,000 crore of debt that the state has will vanish in no time. It only requires a positive frame of mind, it requires the will, and it requires the power to go ahead with it. You have the power, you have the mandate, you have the will, and you have promises to keep, and we will help you in doing that. With this, ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Mr. Devendra Fadnavis, to deliver the Dhananjay Rao Gadgil Memorial Lecture.
Thank you, Mr. Prabhu. On the dais, Shri Deepak Naik, President of MEDC, Ms. Adi Godrej, Minal Mohadikar, Anil Save, my friend Ravi Boratkar, and of course, Shri Chandrasekhar Prabhu. Ladies and gentlemen, when I look at the galaxy of speakers who have presented their vision in this Gadgil Memorial Lecture, it puts immense pressure on me because I am not an economist. I am not as intelligent as branded or depicted by Mr. Naik. I'm a foot soldier. I'm a realist. I'm a person who can empathize, who can understand, who has worked on ground level, who knows what are the problems and has his own way to solve them. A person who is always open for ideas. I'm not a person who feels that I know everything. Please understand my vision. Only my vision is correct. I believe in collective wisdom. So all the wise thoughts I collect from people like Mr. Prabhu and the people sitting on the dais and try to work. But I am indeed very happy and feel proud that I am speaking at this Gadgil Memorial Lecture, because I feel Dhananjay Rao Gadgil was not a mere economist, but he was a reformist. Not just the cooperative movement is his gift to Maharashtra and our country, but also the Gadgil formula, which was mentioned earlier, which has created a place for smaller states to be competitive, to be relevant. With the income distant method, which was devised and accepted by the 11th Finance Commission and thereafter, I feel that that has made our states, smaller states, more competitive. And after this formula was accepted by the Finance Commission, you can see that the smaller states have progressed more than the bigger states. And that was also basic idea behind this formula. So I feel that we need visionaries like Mr. D.R.Gadgil, and I'm sure with a lot of work which he has already done, people like me get a path to walk on. As a tone is set by Mr. Prabhu, and I am thankful to him, but I will apologize that I'll not be able to reflect on every single point you have mentioned, because even if I reflect on all macroeconomic sectoral policies, I would require minimum 3 hours. And let me tell you, I'm a man of few words. Even in assembly, people know that I speak less, but I speak to the point. When I look at Maharashtra, which is one of the most progressive states of our country, which contributes around 15% to the national GDP, accounts for most of the exports, accounts for most of the FDI flow, supposed to be one of the most industrialized state, manufacturing state. When I look at Maharashtra, I feel that the India growth story cannot become a reality unless Maharashtra growth story becomes a reality. When we want India to grow beyond 8%, we must ensure that Maharashtra grows beyond 10%, then only India can grow beyond 8%. And when I look at the entire growth trajectory of Maharashtra, I can see there are certain challenges, certain opportunities, and certain sectors which throw challenges at the same time have opportunities to transform. As rightly said by Mr. Prabhu, the sector which poses the biggest challenge before our economy is the agriculture sector. For past 3 to 4 years, we have constantly seen a negative growth in agriculture sector. When I took over as a chief minister, the first challenge posed to me was, out of 40,000 villages in Maharashtra, 24,000 villages were facing worst drought. And back to back for consecutive 3 years, more than 12,000 villages faced this drought back to back 3 years. The entire rural economy devastated. And as we all know, that although in our GSDP, the share of agriculture sector is 11%, it provides employment to around 45 to 50%. So this is the biggest challenge when half of your population is being employed by a sector which accounts for 11% of your GSDP and which experiences consecutive negative growth. How would you achieve the growth trajectory which is expected from a state like Maharashtra? So we just reflected on the challenges, and the biggest problem which we could point out was lack of irrigation facilities. In Maharashtra, after spending 70,000 crore rupees, we have achieved irrigation potential of 18%. If we look at the national average, it is 44%. If we look at states like Punjab, Haryana, it's more than 90%. And in a state like Maharashtra, it's 18%. But that's not the only challenge. The bigger challenge is the water management. I won't say that all our policies have been incorrect. The policies of my predecessors were also meant to take this state forward, but I feel that we never reflected on the ground realities. Maharashtra is one state where the irrigation potential, so far as flow irrigation is concerned, the achievable potential vis-a-vis the cultivable land in the state is to the max 40 to 45%. So even if you complete all your big irrigation projects, around 50% of your cultivable land will not receive flow irrigation. And without understanding this, we have been spending huge money on big irrigation projects. Once I was going through statistics and I was amazed to know that 40% of the big dams of entire India are in Maharashtra. And still our achieved irrigation potential is 18%. I feel the direction in which we were taking this state. I remember once Rajendra Singh Rana, who is called Jalapurush, was invited in our assembly to speak before the members of both the houses. And I still remember he said, in Maharashtra, I feel that the irrigation department does not work to create water storages, to create irrigation facilities, to benefit farmers. He said, I feel that the only purpose of irrigation department in Maharashtra is to provide benefit to the contractors. And I feel that is what has precisely happened. So I feel that we need a paradigm shift. Yes, we need big dams. I'm not against that. We need storages that are also important. But when we look at our agriculture, what we need is water conservation, distributed water storages through which we can provide in situ moisture, we can provide moisture security to every farmer so that he can take multi crops, he can diversify not just the food basket but also the cash crops, creates an entire chain. And that's why after coming into government, I started a flagship program, Jal Yukta Shivar. Jal Yukta Shivar is a program where I want to make every single village of my state water sufficient. Every drop of water which falls down in a village is stored, is conserved, is absorbed, and it creates a moisture security for the village. And it was not an entirely new scheme. We just found out that there were 14 different schemes of water conservation which were going on in our state. But the thing was, there was no convergence. So what was the result? We were offering shirt to somebody, pant to somebody, cap to somebody, wash to somebody, and nobody was well dressed. So first thing we did was the convergence of schemes, because the schemes were run by different departments. Irrigation department was there, water conservation department was there, animal husbandry department was there, agriculture department was there, micro irrigation department was there. Everybody was working in silos. We said, no, let's come together. So convergence of schemes and convergence of command. I said the collector, the district collector, would be responsible for Jal Yukta Shivar, and under him, for this purpose, all the departments would converge and he will be head of all the departments. So the convergence of schemes, convergence of command, and then I supplemented it with budgetary grant. In last 5 years, we have spent on relief 8,000 crores on relief, and on agricultural investment we have spent 3,000 crores. So if you spend 8,000 crores on relief because there is a drought, because there is a hailstorm, because there is this, because there is that, we have to. Even my government in last 6 months have experienced worst of the climate change, have to pay more than 5,000 crores in just 6 months. But that is not the way to take it forward. Unless you have investment, through relief you cannot change the economy. You can change the economy through investment. So we started investment in Jal Yukta Shivar. And then what we tried, we said, let us make this people movement. If it is a government program, there is no ownership. Structures are created, they are there for say year after year, nobody looks at it. If you have one good rainfall, People forget about the structures. So I said, let's involve the people. And we started involving people. Right now, in 6,000 villages, more than 50,000 works are going on. And today, in the morning, I went to Sangole, Tehsil of Solapur district. And this is the most infamous part of our state, where you actually have perennial drought. No rainfall or very less rainfall. It's one of the highest ranking DPAP talukas of our state. And you'll be amazed that through public participation in Jalyukt Shivar, right now 4,000 JCBs and poklins are working in one single taluka. 1,400 vehicles are carrying the soil. And scientifically, as you rightly said, Mr. Prabhu, fortunately, our forefathers were very intelligent. Their all farming techniques were scientific. In the due course, we lost this scientific approach, and that's why we are in trouble. So what we started? We first started with compartment bunding, where it's not just a compartment bund by pushing the soil, but actually creating a trench-like CCT. So first, when the rain fall will be there, water will be arrested in the compartment itself. Because in water conservation, you have to have a top-down approach. Only then you can conserve the water. Then we started recharging of the wells. Then we started creating cement nala bunds. And after actually creating all the nalas and canals, after removing all the silt and the trees and all the filth which was inside, we have made them flow continuous, and ultimately we are clearing them till they go towards some river where they are connected to the river. So I feel with this approach, the entire ecosystem of water conservation is being created. And let me tell you, the people's participation is amazing. Maharashtra is changing. Go to any village where this work is being carried on. In 6,000 villages, people are doing wonders. We are just helping them. And now, with the convergence in every district, as of now, works worth at least 150 crores have been started. And all the works are small works. I'll just give you one example. In Solapur district, we identified 6,000 structures which were created in past. And we require very little fund to actually recharge and rejuvenate those structures. And if we rejuvenate those 6,000 structures, each structure would require from 50,000 to 2 lakh rupees, not more than that. You'll be amazed that the irrigation potential of one Solapur district, today it is 24%, will go to 42%. In such less expenses. And with participation of people, Now, the worst drought of 1972, when the structures were created, all those structures were lost. We have found out those structures as well, and we are actually rejuvenating even those structures. And we have decided that in next 5 years, 20,000 villages will be made drought free. Moisture security will be provided to the farmers. And once moisture security is provided, our farmers can do wonders. We have not only stopped at that. I said, now in Solapur district, today I told them, yesterday I went to Satara district, Man and Khatav again, most infamous drought affected areas. We are rejuvenating Man River. We are creating structures there. We are rejuvenating all the three rivers in that district. And for rejuvenation of a river, you will be surprised that our initial investment would be not more than 20 crores. So with all small works, all the water conservation techniques, and the entire approach is through aquifer management, as you have rightly said, because unless we know the strength of our aquifers, the water flows through aquifers, and if the water does not reach our aquifer, we'll have no water, and that has happened in many parts of Maharashtra, where you can find the dark zone have been created. And you, again, I went to one place today where they created the structure and were waiting for rains to come. And in unseasonal rains, the structure is full of water and the water level of the wells have risen by 3 meters. So I feel that this is one scheme which will change entire rural economy. Now we want to shift our farmers to micro irrigation systems, drip irrigation, where optimum use of water, which would ensure that the productivity becomes high. At the same time, in the crisis area of districts like Yavatmal and Usmanabad, we are not just providing them with water structures, but we are also providing them with electricity connection. Because not just water, if you provide just water, that would not suffice. So we are also helping them to get electric connection. You will be amazed to know that there has been a waiting list to get an agriculture connection, and the pendency is for 7 years. And our target is by 31st March of next year, there will not be a single farmer who has demanded electric connection and has not got it. Every farmer would get it. We are not stopping at that. We are again trying to create value chains, because it's not just the agri products, but the chains which are more important, so that the farmers get real realization of their commodities. Today, we have the classic APMC system, which is also fairly good, but it has created a monopoly where a farmer is not benefited. So with the World Economic Forum, we have started PPPIAD, Integrated Agricultural Development Program, and we are trying to create value chains for 25 lakh farmers. Few days back, we had a MOU with Ruchi Soya which would cover around 1,50,000 farmers who produce soyabean. Earlier also few chains were created. In our state, there are 10 districts which produce cotton, and only 25% of cotton which our state produce is actually used for value addition for textile in our state, and 75% is processed outside the state. So if we start processing it in our state, in the cotton belt, then the entire value addition of cotton would be transferred to our farmers. They would be benefited, jobs would be created, and I feel that now we have started initiative. Few days back, I opened one textile mill at Amravati. Now Amravati, which is predominantly a cotton belt, we created a MIDC there and designated it as a chemical zone. And for 15 years, not a single chemical industry came there, not a single. Now I have made it textile zone. I have inaugurated one factory, 8 are in line, and in 1 year's time, you will find at least 5 of them operating. So in 9 of the cotton producing districts, we are creating textile clusters from fabric to fashion. As rightly said by our Honorable Prime Minister, these clusters would make the value addition, 8 times value addition would be done in the clusters, so that our farmers would be benefited. On one hand, this is an initiative where I want to revive my agri sector, and on the other side, I want to leverage on the advantage of being one of the pioneer manufacturing state. Because I feel that although we say that 45% of our employment is provided by agriculture, I know that that's not the real employment. At least 10% of the people who seem to get employment in the agri sector are actually underemployed, or they are employed just because they don't find employment elsewhere. So what is the way? In a manufacturing state, we need to take this 10% of load of providing employment from agriculture to manufacturing. Moreover, all of us know that the entire new generation is embracing technology. And even when you go to villages, you find that the boys from the villages are handling mobiles. They take your picture or picture with you. In 5 minutes, it's on WhatsApp. So don't expect them to be farm laborers, to continue as farm laborers anymore. They won't. You need to provide them proper employment. 50% of our population today is below 25 years of age. And this 50% population, which would become your human resource if properly trained, you need to provide them employment. And I feel that this demographic dividend is well understood by our Honorable Prime Minister, and that's why he has started initiative Make in India. And I have understood that that is a way forward, and so I have started initiative Make in Maharashtra. Today, in the manufacturing sector, Our share is 24%. We need to increase it. And I'm very much confident, because recently I visited many countries and I feel that this is right time when we leverage on our human resource. Because entire world, the manufacturing needs a new place. We have seen for a few decades, the entire manufacturing shifted to China. There was skill development, skilled manpower available at a cheap rate, and China became the factory of entire world. And they had a growth story through that manufacturing. But recently, when I went to China with Honorable Prime Minister, I could find out that China, the manufacturing is no more affordable. It's because their demographic curve is changing rapidly. And in next 5 to 7 years, the demographic curve would not allow them free-flowing labor force. At the same time, what has happened in China, that the labor wages have gone up. So no more the lower rung manufacturing or consumer manufacturing is affordable in China. Although with all its economic, I won't say juggleries, but I'm not finding a different word. So please tell me, because I don't want to sound negative. They are sustaining it. But for a long time, they won't be able to sustain. And the only place where the entire manufacturing could be shifted is India. We have human resource. If we skill them, I'm sure that we have resources, we have human resource, physical resources, entire manufacturing base can be created here. And that's why I feel that manufacturing is one sector where in Maharashtra, we need more focus. In all these visits, whosoever I've met, most of the global giants and even the people from SMEs in Germany, in China, they are eager to come to India. And they are more eager to come to Maharashtra, because they know that this is the place, this is the destination. As of now, the belt near Pune has developed as manufacturing hub. We are trying to develop Aurangabad, Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. We are trying to showcase Mihan at Nagpur. We are trying to create few dye ports. And I feel that, as rightly said by Mr. Prabhu, if we provide ease in doing business, manufacturing is our future. It's our present as well, but also it would be our future. And that has been precisely the focus of my government. I've reduced the permission regime. Initially, 76 permissions were needed in designated industrial area to start an industry. So we said, let's bring it down to 25. In last 3 months, I could bring it down to 37. 15th of June is my deadline by which I need to bring it down to 25. And I'm bringing it on a IT platform. There are so many regulations which we have put on automated route. There are certain permissions which we are trying to give in just 7 days. Entire interdepartmental massive work is going on to reduce all this permission regime and regulatory regime. As rightly said, you're talking of a restaurant. You said you require 35 permissions, but do you know to put up a hotel, how many permissions you need? you need 180 permissions. And believe me, in coming few days, we'll bring them down to 20 from 180. We have already made the framework. Now, certain departmental issues, because you know, in government, nobody wants to give up his power. So I have to work with every department. And to take away the power is a bad job, actually. It makes you infamous. But I have to do it. Because if I want the industrial sector, the service sector to grow in my state, then ease in doing business is the key. We've started amending the Factories Act. We want to actually do away with the Inspector Raj. We believe that our industrialists, our businessmen are also truthful citizens. Why every time we should look at them with suspicion? So we said, now we'll put most of the things on self-certification mode. And with the self-certification mode, once in 5 years, once in 3 years, somebody can go and check. But that too, what we have ensured, as of today, if an inspector feels that he needs to give a treat to his wife, he reaches some of the industry, and you know what happens then. So said, nothing doing. Henceforth, inspector will not decide which factory is going to visit. We have made a computerized program through which it would be decided and told on that day that, look, today you have to go to this factory and check this thing, no other thing, only these four things. And once he goes and check it, in 72 hours, he has to upload his report on our website. So there is no time left for lendin. I think that ease in doing business is a key. In the ease in doing business index, we have fared 142 in 180 countries. And the key is Mumbai. So we have set a target for ourselves, at least for Mumbai, we'll create a framework wherein ease in doing business, we will be in first 50 countries of world when Mumbai will be evaluated. Series of amendments have been done. If I start speaking on each one of them, I think I'll take more time. Already I have taken a lot of time. So the entire focus is to create entire ecosystem for the manufacturing sector. We are coming up with many policies, a policy for SMEs, a policy for IT, a policy for retail. For different sectors, we are coming up with a policy. And I feel that you will see a lot of investment coming in Maharashtra. This is one more sector which I would speak and then I would stop. Because if you hand over a mic to a politician, handing over a mic is in your hand. When to stop? Even the chairperson of our Legislative Assembly finds it difficult to stop us. Maharashtra is most urbanized state. And we have huge potential in urbanization. As of now, we have looked at urbanization as evil. our entire focus was stop urbanization. We used to feel that India lives in villages. As villages are not prospering, people are coming to cities, please stop them. That was the approach. But if you look at all the developed economies, you cannot stop urbanization. The only strategy is to manage urbanization. And that's what we want to do. That is our focus. We want to manage urbanization. The Urban Development Department, which is with me now, was working only, again, I don't want to blame anybody, but when I look at the files, I could see that it was working only for changing the reservations. Because when I took over, you'll be surprised, nearly 30 development plans were waiting sanction of government for last 7 years. And for a city, if you prepare a development plan and don't sanction it for 7 years, the entire land use is changed. So after 7 years, even if you sanction a development plan, the place which is reserved for ground, you will find a shopping complex already being there, or a place which is let's say reserved for a school, already somebody has built a beautiful house and staying there. So what I did was, I immediately, in 2 months' time, I've sanctioned all the 30 development plans, and today, not a single development plan is pending with me. And now I've made it a point that the development plans, unless you have a strategy to manage urbanization, how would you take the challenge of urbanization? So we have already started it. In cities like Mumbai, where you can find a lot of infrastructure deficit, for last 15 years, the amount of infrastructure which we should have or could have created, we could not. I realize, and when I look back, in late 90s, when I used to go to Delhi, I used to feel very good because that time I could find that Mumbai was far, far better than Delhi. The infrastructure of Mumbai was good, better than Delhi. But in last 15 years, Mumbai is way back of Delhi. Delhi has created so much of infrastructure. So basically now our focus is on creating infrastructure. We are trying to create the coastal road, and I am sure very soon you will hear announcement that the central government has given approval to the coastal road, which would decongest the Western Expressway and the western part of our city. We are trying to also create, and when I say this, I have also been hearing it for 15 years, the Trans Harbor Link. But let me assure you that we will not only sanction it, but in much, much less time, we'll create it. I went to the Trans Harbor Link at China, and you'll be amazed that a 42-kilometer Trans Harbor Link was built in the Chengdu province in just 3.5 years. And for a 5-kilometer Worli-Bandra Sea Link, it took us 9 years. So I think that we are trying to create the infrastructure. We have already sanctioned the new Mumbai airport. The bids are open. Soon we will award the contract. We'll start it, and by 2019, I want first flight to fly from the new Mumbai airport. And by then, if we don't create Trans-Harbour Link, and if you start all the flights from the new Mumbai airport, I'll be never able to catch a flight. So at least for my benefit, I must create the Trans-Harbour Link. In the MMR region as well, we are trying to create a new city, Naina, which has an area more than entire Mumbai. It's a 600 square kilometer city, which will have in itself 30 smart cities. And also, I'm trying to revive the new Mumbai SEZ. Because I feel that the new Mumbai SEZ has a potential to fuel our growth for next 20 years. Its proximity from port, from airport, is such that it can actually fuel the economy of entire state and country. Not just Mumbai or MMR region, we are trying to develop 10 smart cities in Maharashtra. And people feel that when I talk about smart cities, people think that smart cities means cities which have Wi-Fi. I think smart cities are the cities which use their resources optimally, which create the entire infrastructure which is at optimum cost. The capex and opex is optimized so that entire created facility is well controlled, well financed, and well operated, and entirely through e-systems, e-governance. So I feel that creating a smart city is not for only for the affluent. Creating a smart city is for a common man to have a quality of life at optimum cost. And that's what we are trying to do. Moreover, there are many initiatives which we have taken so that the urban infrastructure is created. I think I am running short of time, so I would just say that roads, ports, airports, power, all these sectors, we have actually started concentrating on. Mr. Kalantri is here. He met me down. And for the first time, two ports, we are trying to connect not only through roads, but through rail and an initiative, a special purpose vehicle to create a rail link has been created where the concessioner, the MMB, our port trust, and the central government railways department have come together to create the railway network, because I feel that the port capacity which we should have created, we could not create it, and the port-led development is actually a key. You can find that wherever there has been a port-led development, it has contributed most to the GDP. So that is also one area of focus. In power sector, we are trying to optimize our capacities. We are trying to actually enhance our plant load factor. And let me assure you, as of now, the industrial power in our state, the tariff is highest amongst all states. And unless we bring it down, our manufacturing cannot become competitive. So I'm sure this would be the first tariff petition by our state utility, which will be once sanctioned, because it's in the domain of MERC, so I must not say, but you will find a huge change. Earlier in last 12 years, every tariff petition has increased the tariff. I am sure this will be first tariff petition which will decrease the tariff substantially. And for that, we are not providing subsidy. Without subsidy, with the optimum utilization of our resources, we are doing it. So I feel that basically we want growth. There has been a classical debate for last many years in our country, where passion for poor, compassion for poor, and passion for growth, where Mr. Amartya Sen, the Nobel laureate and the great thinker, wanted our country to have compassion for poor. And on the other hand, Professor Bhagwati and Professor Pangadia, who is now Deputy Chairman of Niti Aayog, wanted us to have focus on growth. I feel that the compassion for poor is possible only through growth, only through providing jobs. By providing doles, you can garner votes, but you cannot grow. For growth, I think you need to have a focus by providing jobs, by providing an ecosystem where all the sectors of economy could grow. And I'm trying to take this state on that growth path. I'm sure with the cooperation of MEDC, which has been really instrumental in providing policy support to the government, with your help, we would find a right path and take this state to new heights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Minister, for such a wonderful disposition. We will have question and answers now, but before that, there is a small task to be done. We had conducted a study on all the banking, best banking practices in different parts of the world, and the best and the most successful banking practices, which even the Reserve Bank was looking forward to. In the process of new reforms, we set all the economists to work, and this is the a document which has come, which not just people in Bombay or in India, not just the Reserve Bank of India, but we shall see people all over the world look at this as an important document. So I would first request the Chief Minister to unveil the document. Before that, the sponsors of this study, LIC, Life Insurance Corporation, Mr. Vikas Agarwal, Exim Bank, the Deputy MD, Ms. David, and NABARD, the Deputy General Manager, Nair Gopakumaran. Please come on the stage, and the Chief Minister will inaugurate the publication and hand over the copies to you. with that, we come to the question answer session. I would request our president, Commander Deepak Nayak, to moderate the questions. The chief minister has to go. We have only some time for the questions. Because this is a tradition of the D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture, we will take only a few questions. Just a
minute. I'll take few questions. And remaining questions you can send on our portal Aple Sarkar. We'll reply you.
Right. Sir.
That's indeed very nice. We will move turn by turn.
Before we start
with the question answer session, let me just say two things. One, this D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture has seen a shift from theorizing and teaching economists to a functioning practical economist. Second, the last sentence the speaker today made was compassion for poor is only possible for growth. And on my right hand side, I have an excellent example, and he probably doesn't know, but I checked out his balance sheets on the net, and I find that he's been, insofar as the CSR is concerned, he pays his entire company's CSR out of his personal money. Instead of his shareholders, which is a remarkable plus. Thank you, sir, for setting a good example. May we now invite, for the next 10 minutes, make your questions as short as possible so that there are more questions.
Sir, if I may.
If we may ask FAM Farm, please.
Could I ask a question, please?
Yes.
It's not a question, but I would like to first of all say that I've never, ever come across a chief minister who has been so practical in his approach, who has thought of the state first and self last. It really makes me happy to hear that. Having said that, sir, I just want to make one comment, and that is, when you want to kickstart an economy, the first thing that all developed countries do is map their country. And I mean mapping it from underground, the wealth underneath your feet. You talked about aquifers, Mr. Prabhu. Yeah. You talked about aquifers. We are actually carrying out this work in India. We don't need to go to MIT specialists for this and consultants. We're actually carrying this out in India. So
we'll certainly take your help.
Thank you.
Sir, my name is Viren Shah. I'm a president of Federation of Retail Traders Welfare Association. We have lakhs of shopkeepers of Mumbai under us. First of all, we congratulate you that you have allowed 365 days open for all the shops. That's a good step and everybody is appreciating. Sir, I have three questions. One is, you have been silent on the old tenants. Though I have many buildings as a landlord, but I am favoring all my tenants who are there for many years. And today, all these tenants are going to be dishoused with your new draft policy. So I want that questions to be addressed because you have spoke about farmers, other part. Second, sir, Prime Minister's, Honorable Prime Minister's team has been saying India's nation will be of futures, all this will be a sales boys and sales girls. And FDI policy of UPA, you have allowed them to continue all these years, you've been objecting. Sir, why today FDI in multi-brand retail is allowed? And third, sir, Prime Minister openly said, LBT is a loot Bartnicki technique. And LBT is still not yet been removed. You have promised 1st August it will be removed. What about octroi, sir? Octroi is also old and outdated. Only in Ethiopia is out there, nowhere else. Sir, I want these three issues to be addressed, sir. Thank you.
I think the entire time would be consumed. First of all, thank you, because I just said to Mr. Prabhu that I could not speak on the housing issue, which is very important here. So the new housing policy, in fact, is a draft policy. And I have already actually put it in the public domain. And that's what I want to do. Actually, the policy is prepared by Yashoda. And now, after putting it into public domain, and let me tell you that it has not gone to my cabinet, even my cabinet. So before going to cabinet, I want everybody to actually have a look at that policy to suggest the changes. As you have pointed out about the rented properties and the Rent Act, whatever provisions are there in our policy, they are open for a change. Please come to us, tell us the facts, convince us, and we will change it. That's what is expected. We want everybody to actually have their say, and we are totally flexible, open for change. Secondly, you talked about retail. Basically, we are opposed to FDI in multi-brand retail. That is our known position. So far as the economic decisions are concerned, normally it is very difficult to reverse a decision which is taken. It actually requires a lot of contemplation. And what happens to the investment which has been allowed? The moment you say that the allowed investment go back, the entire global community feels that this is not a place to invest, because they often change their policies. So consistency of policy is what is required for entire global community. So right now, I don't want to comment entirely on it until I contemplate. The third question was about octroi, and so LBT is going surely on from 1st of August. And for octroi, already the GST bill is passed in Parliament in the lower house. By July, it will be passed in the upper house, and the GST bill has deleted entry 52 from the Constitution. So not just LBT or octroi, no such local tax would be there. All the taxes would be subsumed in GST. So maybe you will have to wait for 1 year.
So my name is Bhushan Punamia. मैं एक छोटा सा SME हूँ. Make in India का जो dream है, हमने अभी एक नया unit start किया वसई में. हम China से 4 लोगों को लेके आए हैं, उनको यहाँ India में job दे रहे हैं. India में mobile assembly कर रहे हैं. ये पहला unit होगा जो mobile assembly करेगा महाराष्ट्र में. हमने bank loan के लिए apply किया. Bank वाले clearly बोलते हैं SME को loan नहीं मिलेगा. SME के लिए स्पेशली एक बेनिफिट भी है, एक स्कीम है CGTMSE, जहाँ पे 1 crore तक मैन्युफैक्चरिंग यूनिट को सब्सिडी मिलती है और विदाउट कोलेटरल लोन मिलती है. कोई बैंक देने को तैयार नहीं है. SME को इस तरह ट्रीट किया जाता है कि बोलते हैं आपका घर रखो तो हम बात करेंगे, नहीं तो बात ही नहीं करेंगे. सर मैं चाहता हूँ अगर आप सही में अगर SME को चाहते हैं कि बॉम्बे ग्रो, मेजर SME बॉम्बे में है, जो छोटे छोटे यूनिट्स हैं अभी, मैं यूनिट मेरे को एकदम रेडी है, इम्पोर्ट करना है मुझे फंड्स चाहिए, फंड्स नहीं मिलते.
देखिए SMEs के लिए अभी केंद्र सरकार ने भी कुछ फंड शुरू किए हैं. नहीं बिल्कुल यहाँ पर है, आपको चाहिए अगर आपको उसमें सहायता चाहिए तो हम सहायता करेंगे. अभी हमने भी सिडबी के साथ कुछ टाइप किया हुआ है जिसमें हम SMEs को, राज्य सरकार भी मदद करना चाहती है. तो निश्चित रूप से आपकी जो केस है उस केस को आप हमारे तक भेजिए, उसमें अगर फैसिलिटेशन की आपको आवश्यकता है तो हम जरूर करेंगे.
इसके पहले मैं जो आपका इवेंट हुआ था जब आप आए थे, और सुभाष देसाई, मेरे गोरेगांव से ही हूँ मैं, सुभाष देसाई जी को अच्छी तरह जानता हूँ. मगर आप कोई बैंक में जाए और SME को कहे SME लोन दो, नहीं देता, कोई नहीं देता सर.
देखिए अभी बैंकों को भी कुछ प्रायोरिटी सेट करके दी हुई है सरकार ने, मुझे लगता है उसमें SMEs का जो फंडिंग है एक बहुत बड़ी प्रायोरिटी अभी बैंकों को दी हुई है. फिर भी अगर ये बैंकें नहीं कर रही है तो अप्रोप्रिएट अथॉरिटी को मैं इन्फॉर्म करूँगा.
सर
please give us complaint, we'll take action.
Sir, fantastic deliberation. मुद्दा मराठीत बोलतो सुधीर मांडके. दोन गोष्टी, एक तर आपण कोस्टल रोडचं बोलतोय, देवानी आपल्याला 200 लेनचा रस्ता फुकट दिलेला आहे समुद्राचा, वाय नॉट डू दॅट. जर कोस्टल रोड आपण 1000 रुपयात केला तर हा रस्ता आपल्याला रुपयात होईल आणि ते जर 20 वर्ष काम चाललं तर हे फक्त 6 महिन्यात होईल. नंबर 1. नंबर 2, सी इज द वेल्थ ऑफ द स्टेट. 720 किलोमीटर आपण एक टन त्या बोटीने दर साधारण 10 किलोमीटरला करतो, 40 ते 50 टन पर डे करतील. एक 150 आपण बोट्स घेऊन ताबडतोब या लोकांना डिस्ट्रीब्युट का करत नाही. कोस्टल रोडचं हे 100 लेनचं रोडचं तुम्ही थोडासा विचार करा आणि ते 6 महिन्यात चालू होऊ शकेल.
फार चांगला आपण या ठिकाणी सांगितलं. जे ईस्टर्न सी फ्रंट आहे त्या ठिकाणी आम्ही हे सुरू करतो आहोत. त्या संदर्भातला आमचा निर्णय झालेला आहे. ब्रेक वॉटर आम्ही तयार करतो आहोत आणि ईस्टर्न सी फ्रंटवर आम्ही ते करतो आहोत. वेस्टर्न सी फ्रंटवर ते अजून फिजिबल होत नाही आहे. त्याचं कारण ईस्टर्न सी फ्रंटवर आपण 11 महिने ते चालवू शकू पण वेस्टर्न सी फ्रंटवर आपण 7 महिने चालवू शकतो, त्यामुळे त्याची फिजिबिलिटी येत नाही आहे. आणि म्हणून त्याच्यावर अजून काय उपाययोजना किंवा जगात काय अशा म्हणजे अशा वेदरमध्ये केलं जातं याचा स्टडी आम्ही करतो आहोत.
Sir, I have one question. We came here with lot of expectations and our expectations have been more than met. So we are very proud to have such a chief minister who peeps into the future and acts. I had just one question about labor, because you mentioned that a very important point that agriculture, the value addition has to take place in state. And if that has to happen, then I think change in labor laws is very important. I am a senior retired banker and I had occasion to deal with many top corporates and multinationals. As back as 15 years also, we found that the corporate offices were here, but all the factories were in Ankleshwar and Vapi. And because Gujarat was very labor friendly, there was a very large scale migration. Now, of course, things are changing. But when will Maharashtra follow the example of Rajasthan and go for a labor law? Because I think that will make a lot of difference.
We have already started working in that direction. Soon we are changing few labor laws. I feel right now the labor laws, in fact in our country, to change labor law is a taboo. And if you change the labor laws, then you are only pro-industrialist and anti-labor. And your sarkar becomes suited-booted sarkar. But still.
Yes, sir. But when we are talking of productivity,
yes,
I think it's
yes,
very
yes,
important.
Yes, I totally agree. And that is why even taking that risk of getting a blame of suited, booted, anti-poor, anti-labor government, we are trying to change the labor laws, because I feel right now the labor laws are neither benefiting laborers nor are they benefiting the industries. So we are changing them, and if you properly change them, they would not only benefit the industry, but they would benefit the laborers more, because the entire labor market would be expanded. And right now, we know that there are unfair labor practices going on. Why? It's because the artificial barriers which we have created through our labor laws have compelled people to actually go for unfair labor practices. So if you create an ecosystem where fair labor practices are practicable, then people would always do that. That's what we are doing. I feel the changes which we are making would not only benefit the industries, but would benefit the laborers more.
Sir, I am
missing. Last question.
Yes. Sir, on the agriculture value change, you have focused very properly, and the cotton where which I am concentrating is a point at issue. Sir, you have concentrated on the value additions on the upward side to the textile mills. The greatest thing which the World Bank report, of which I was the chairman, we have found that the backward integration of value chain like cotton is totally missing in our country, which can produce immense wealth, number one. Number two, that the agricultural waste can create lot of good value out of the agriculture waste, about which MEDC a few years back had a good amount of discussion, which of course I was there part of it, and we have the MEDC has given a report also. So this is a wonderful thing, and on the agriculture, this could give us a very good this thing, and I compliment for your initiative on value chain. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. We'll take all the consultations from you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, I am a small-scale industry, and I have been working on a seawater desalination and wastewater reclamation. We have excellent sea face, and we have been bringing water from far distance. If we could convert seawater into potable water, this could help the urbanization and also bring down the cost. The real cost of seawater desalination is not more than 10 paise a liter. But unfortunately, the rates today are quoted are more than 5 rupees, and we sell it for 10 rupees a bottle. I think this could change the economy. And I have been giving demonstrations for the last 20 years. I already supplied such equipments to ONGC, and probably we have been working on this. All the politicians have come, met me, seen all those demonstrations, but I did not have the art and skill to sell them. That's what I have been very categorically stating this.
If your technology has art and skill, please come to me.
I have given a know-how to the whole world on recombinants.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll close sir, the
sir,
question answer session here.
Ekats. No, prashna
no,
nahi
no, please, no more
prashna nahi
we are running
sir,
out
of vinanti.
Please, we are running out of time. We got to stick to some schedule of the Chief Minister as a busy man. Thank you very much. Please sit down. We have two things to do hereafter. One is, of course, to present a bouquet to our three sponsors, and after that, I'm going to request Meenal, our Vice President, to say the vote of thanks. And of course, the national anthem thereafter. Yeah. Could I call Mr. Agarwal, Mr. Raskina, and Mr. Gopakumar from the NABARD? With that, I know there are many unanswered or rather unasked questions, if you wish to. I'm quite certain that after this interaction, on a different forum, perhaps not D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture, but our Honorable Chief Minister, next time will come here as Chief Minister, not as a speaker, and still address the August Assembly of our members. May I now request our Vice President, Ms. Meenal Mohadikar, to give a vote of thanks.
Honorable Chief Minister, Mr. Devendra Ji Fadnavis, Mr. Adi Godrej, dignitaries on the dais, dignitaries of the dais, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. Year after year, this is our flagship event for MEDC, that is today's D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture. Today we are here with Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Shri Devendra Ji Fadnavis. We are grateful to Shri Devendra Ji Fadnavis for this function. We are really thankful to him being with us for this evening. Meeta Manen, Pahila Chief Minister Asel, ki jani pratek prashna chi uttara dili, and he is so positive, and he's, I will say that he studied also all the questions. And as a chief minister, he knows each and everything. Manje tanni prashnanchita uttara dilich, parantu he is ready to change everything. That is the plus point and positive thing. So give him a big hand first. Pahila CM Asel ki, why I'm telling you? Because he has inaugurated one function at Delhi, where on 14th of November, there was an exhibition, and basically that the exhibition was there. Different states have kept their products, and he had come to inaugurate the function in Maharashtra, and he was the first chief minister that he has come to each and every stall. That is the actually thing, because the people are going and just inauguration is done and they are going back. But he went to each and every stall and he saw everybody's products. So I'm really hats off to you, sir. Because of your presence, our MEDC is really, we are really so happy. Now I'm really thankful to Honorable Adi Godrej Ji, who is our ex-president, to grace this occasion. I'm thankful to all my senior presidents who are present here, Mr. Minu Modi, Mr. Sharad Kulkarni. Then I'm really thankful to all our council generals of different countries, those who are present here. Ma'am, I met you down, so really thankful to you, ma'am. All our office bearers, Mr. Anil Save, Mr. Anil Ravi Boratkar, Mr. Sriram Dandekar, Mr. Prakash Patil, Mr. Anil Hatkar, Dilip Bhatkar, I'm really thankful to you, everybody. I'm thankful to all presidents of other Chamber of Commerce, those who are present here, Indian Merchant Chamber, Maharashtra Chamber, Bombay Chamber of Commerce, TISA, COSIA, other different organizations and different members to other organizations also. I will say Mr. Mohan Gurnani from FARM, really thankful to you, sir, because I've worked with you even in Maharashtra Chamber of Commerce. Then I will be happy that thanks to Mr. Atul Kulkarni and Mr. Buddhiraja, who is present here with us. I'm thankful to IAS President, Mr. Vaidya and his team. They are with us. Not only here, they are with us, sir. We are always organizing a MSME program with Indian Education Society every year in the month of August. So we will be happy if you can come there and inaugurate that function in the month of August, sir. Then I am thankful to government officials and all secretaries. My sincere thanks to all sponsors of this event, LIC, Exim Bank, as well as NABARD. Thanks to all the participation. Thanks to the press and media people. Thanks to everybody for their presence. D.R.Gadgil Memorial Lecture is the major thought process for this Maharashtra economy by MEDC, which is we are doing so many years. So because of your presence, we are taking this you are with us, and we look forward for your continuous support. Thank you, everybody. Thanks a lot.
Gentlemen, the national anthem. Janagana Mana Adhinayaka Jayahe Bharata Bhagya Vidhaya.